thank you for tuning in to the Victory and Praise broadcast of Tabernacle Baptist Church, located at 519 West 19th Avenue in Gastonia, North Carolina, where Dr. Benjamin Hinton is our senior pastor. Our vision is to exalt Christ, evangelize the world, and empower believers for victorious kingdom living. Now get ready for a life-changing word. Hello, Tabernacle. Get ready. It's time for your TBC Connection, keeping you in the know for the week ahead. Tabernacle is excited to be a community partner with Contegra Health by partnering with them to host a COVID vaccination clinic event in our Family Life Center on March 5th and 6th. To be eligible to receive the vaccination, you must meet the following criteria: be 65 years of age or older, a healthcare worker, school system worker, or child care provider. Register today to receive your COVID vaccination appointment by going to our website, tbcgastonia.org, and selecting one of the event link dates. Join us as we celebrate 30 years of unprecedented favor during the 30th pastoral anniversary of Dr. Benjamin and Minister Tangela Hinton. The virtual experience will take place on March 10th and 14th. First Ladies Night will take place Wednesday, March 14th at 7 p.m. The guest speaker is Lady Tarsha Jefferson of All Nations Church of God in Christ. On Sunday, March 14th at 10 a.m., the guest speaker will be Pastor James Wilkes Jr. of Elon First Baptist Church. Afterward, show your love and appreciation by joining us at 12 p.m. for the drive-through celebration on our church campus.
Well, praise the Lord. Thank you for joining us for another edition of BET, that's Bible Empowerment Teaching, here at TBC. We call it BET at TBC, Bible Empowerment Teaching, here at the Tabernacle Baptist Church. I'm your host and teacher, Dr. Benjamin Hinton. What a joy it is to share the Word of God with you week after week. I want to thank you for joining us today and always in these teaching, learning experiences. And I praise God for the Word. Amen. Why don't you invite some friends and invite them to connect with us here at TBC, and love to have you as a part of our class. Amen. Well, before we do anything else, let's get started with a word of prayer. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bless you, we thank you, we love you for this new day you have made. We rejoice and we are glad in it. We thank you, Father, for your blessing, your favor, your hand of mercy, your anointing. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for dwelling with us. You are our teacher. You are our life coach. So we ask you to guide us in this teaching learning experience together. Anoint me as a vessel that I may be a conduit to pour out your word to your people. We pray this in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Well, as it is our order, I want you to grab your Bible, your iPad, your iPhone. Let's declare our faith in God together. Amen. Shout with me, the Bible is the holy word of God. I am what it says I am. I am a faith believer. My faith comes by my hearing, and my hearing by the word of God. As I read the word, meditate on the word, practice and apply the word, I can declare every blessing God has for my life. I declare and decree, I am phenomenally blessed. Amen. Why don't you declare that on yourself? I'm phenomenally blessed. Say it with a Holy Ghost attitude. I am phenomenally blessed. Amen. You got to keep speaking that word on your life and declaring what God has said about you and what God is saying to you. Amen. Well, today's I want to continue in the teaching series. We've been talking about the Holy Spirit. Amen. We've been talking about the person, the purpose, and the power of the Holy Spirit. The person, the purpose, and the power of the Holy Spirit. It's important to us to understand who He is and how He operates in our lives as faith believers. So many believers live beneath their privilege as a believer, as a child of God. We say we're Christian, but many people don't have the proper connection. They're not walking in the fullness of God, or should I say in the person of the Holy Spirit, who is God manifested in us, Christ manifested in us, who enable us to live at the level God wants us to live. And so we've been talking about who He is, and I've talked about that invisible, indwelling presence of God, the Holy Spirit, and we talked about things that he does for us. We talked about who He is, first of all, but then we talked about at least His works, how He works in us. And we remember we said that the Holy Spirit is not an abstract it, but He is a person. He is the third person of the Trinity, of the Godhead, God the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. The baptismal formula Jesus gave at the resurrection, Matthew 28, go ye therefore into all the world and baptize them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so on last time, we began by sharing with you some primary works of the Holy Spirit. So if you need a title, a tag, or a label for this teaching, the primary works of the Holy Spirit, and we talked about at least 10 things. He does many, many, many more. We can't limit God. That's the thing about the understanding who God is and who Christ is and who the Holy Spirit is. Amen. You can't limit Him, but just for teaching purposes today, I want to talk about 10 things. We've already shared 5 of those, but let me reiterate 5 of those, and then I'll begin with the second 5, amen, in our teaching series, amen. First of all, we said He convicts, or He corrects and convinces us, amen. Then secondly, we said He regenerates us. He gives regeneration. That's part of our salvation, part of our new birth, our resurrected life in Christ. He regenerates us. Then we said He baptizes us. Amen. He baptizes us. Remember, amen. Remember in Matthew chapter 3, John said, I've baptized you with water unto repentance, but the one coming after me, his shoelaces, I'm not worthy to untie or tie up. He's going to baptize you with fire and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And then we also heard Jesus say that in Acts chapter 1 in his conversation prior to Pentecost. He said, John baptized with water unto repentance, but you're going to be baptized with the Holy Spirit, with the Holy Ghost, and with fire not many days from here. Well, what does the Holy Spirit do? What does water do? Water washes. Water cleanses. What does fire do? Fire purges. Fire burns away. So it not only purges us, but it also purifies us. But the Holy Spirit ignites. He gives fire. He gives excitement. Amen. He gives the super to our natural. Amen. So we operate in the supernatural power and presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So praise God. Praise God. We thank God for the Holy Spirit that He baptizes us. But the thing, amen, and you hear, and let me just borrow some language that we may hear from what is called the FBH, Fire Baptized Holiness Church. One of the things they in their teaching and their sharing, that I've been saved, sanctified, and fire baptized. Amen. So they include that. But, we understand teachings, doctrine. We may use different language in our sharing, but amen, we understand that there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And when that one baptism is not just the water baptism, but is the baptism in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, is being dying to the old, being raised to the new, amen? And so we're raised to the new, but we're raised and we're baptized in the water and with the fire of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. Amen. And the next thing we said, the fourth thing, Holy Spirit intercedes for us. We talked about that in Romans chapter 8. And then the fifth thing, the Holy Spirit anoints us. He anoints us. Amen. And that word anoint means to cover, to smear, to paint, to overshadow us. He anoints us. He affirms who we are as children of God. Amen. Praise God. Now, the sixth thing I want to share with you today as we continue, I wanted to reiterate the former lesson so that we'll get it. Amen. I want you to get it. So many times we rush through the lessons of God. We rush through about the teaching of the Holy Spirit. But in this season, listen, in these challenging times, we, in order to live in the victory and the power of God, we got to have the Holy Spirit. I thank God for the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the sixth thing I want to, the sixth thing the Holy Spirit does for us is he fills us. Amen. Can you shout fills us? Amen. He fills us. Not emotional, F-E-E, not F-E-E-L, but he F-I-L-L. He doesn't just F-E-E-L, he F-I-L-L fills us with the indwelling of his presence. He fills us, amen, with the indwelling of his presence, which gives us his joy, which gives us his peace, which affirms his presence with us, amen. And we began today by looking at Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, amen. Acts chapter 2, let's go there very quickly, amen. Remember in Acts chapter 1, Jesus tells us about the promise of the coming of the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 2, Jesus has ascended. The angel said, the same Jesus that you see go up, he's going to come back again. And the Bible says in the opening verse of chapter 2 of Acts says, when the day of Pentecost, amen, had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. They were all in one accord in one place. Now, this is a carryover. This really is an extended prayer meeting, because when you go to chapter 1 of Acts, they were in prayer along with the women in the upper room. They continued in prayer with the women, the disciples, and now they are there in one place on one accord, and the Bible says, amen, in one accord, and the Bible says, and verse 2, and suddenly, all right, and suddenly there came, notice, a sound where? From heaven. Jesus, remember, he has ascended up, and he said, I'm going to send my comforter, my paraclete, my helper back to you. And so the Bible says there was a sound from heaven as a what? Rushing mighty wind. All right. Remember, one of the terms that we use about the Holy Spirit is breath, ruach, wind. Amen. Pneuma. Amen. So the Holy Spirit came as a rushing mighty wind, and notice it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Verse number 3 says, then there appeared. Now look at the manifestation. Now, because the Holy Spirit is coming to the earth to fill and fulfill the role that Christ had already begun, he comes back as a helper, as a comforter, to fill the void of his physical presence. He comes to provide a physical or spiritual presence. All right? Look at the Bible. Look at the word. Look at what the Bible said. And the Bible said, it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And verse number 3 says, then there appeared to them divided or cloven tongues, all right, as of fire, as of, meaning it was like fire, all right? And one sat upon each of them, all right? And they were all, there it is right there, filled with what? The Holy Spirit. And they began to speak with other tongues or other languages as the Spirit gave them utterance. Amen. Let's go back and unpack this. Notice now how the Holy Spirit was manifested to them as God's initial outpouring or inpouring or infilling to give them a sense of visible evidence of who it is that and what's happening among them. So the Holy Spirit came in this form, law of first mention or filling them, there appeared upon them divided tongue, notice like fire that sat upon each of them, so that there was no doubting, questioning about the fact that each of them in the room experienced the same feeling, if you will, of the presence of God, the presence of the Holy Spirit sat upon every one of them and filled them. And as he filled them, they began to speak. They began to speak in other tongues, other languages, as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, a lot of people get into theological dialogue and discussion about, well, did they speak in an unknown tongue or did they speak in a language that was known? Well, the text says here that they spoke in a different tongues or different languages, but as the Spirit gave them utterance. Let's keep reading, because the word says, and there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews. Remember, they had come for the Feast of Pentecost, so this was a national or even almost an international gathering of people who had come, who had been Jews, who had dispersed from the diaspora, but they had come back for the day of Pentecost, to celebrate Pentecost, and the Bible says there were dwelling in Jerusalem devout men. Amen. Devout men. These were committed men. Notice the Bible said, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were what? Confused, because everyone heard them speaking in his own tongue or his own language, all right? His own dialect, all right? And the Bible says, then they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, look, are not all these that speak, are they not Galileans? Are we not hearing the same people from the same region? But how is it that we hear each in our own language or dialect in which we were born? He says, we hear Parthians, we hear Medes, we hear Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya adjoining Cyrene. We hear visitors from Rome. We hear Jews. We hear proselytes. We hear Cretans. We hear Arabians. We hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God. So the key is not get so caught up in the fact of tongue, but languages. They were hearing. This was a global gathering. God made it a global gathering in order to demonstrate his presence and his power to speak and to operate in all languages. This was a global God. God is not just a regional God, but he's global. The Holy Spirit is not just given to a select few or just to the Jews, but God showed them the power of his promise is available to every nation. every nation, the global, the Holy Spirit is not limited to a select few, but he is available to all. Oh, praise God. Amen. Amen. And notice now, what were they saying? They were speaking. What were they speaking? The wonderful, hallelujah, the works of God. Amen. The key I want you to understand is they were filled. Amen. And their filling of the Holy Spirit manifested in this upper room so that they were all amazed and they were perplexed at the same time, saying to one another, what could this mean? What does this mean? How are we hearing the mighty works of God? How are we hearing all this praise going on? And then you're always going to have some that are clear, some that are asking questions, but you're going to have those that are going to mock. Some going to make fun. Some going to speak and ridicule what they don't know. It's just like church. People will speak and talk against what goes on in one church or what goes on, what the Lord is doing when they don't know. They're speaking out of ignorance. And that's why you can't just get on every bandwagon, everybody just chatting about the church, but you got to know that some people are speaking ignorantly what they don't know. All right? They'll speak critically and they'll mock. They'll make fun of pastors and preachers and prophets. They'll make fun of people who praise God in their own way, but you got to know what you know and not let what folks say, all right, what people speak or what people think to discourage you from praising God. The Bible says in verse 13, you had to mock. Others were mocking. Amen. And what did they say? They're saying they are full of new wine. All right. And that brings us to verse number 14, because Peter, who became the mouthpiece of the church, he became a great leader of the church, a one that walked with Jesus. Peter standing up with the 11 raised his voice and said to them, he said, listen, men of what? Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let it be known to you and heed my word. Listen to my word. He said, these are not drunk as you think or as you suppose, but notice, Peter took them to the word. He said, they are not drunk as you suppose. First of all, it's too early in the morning. Amen. Since it is the ninth hour or the third hour, he says, since it is the third hour, it's too early in the morning. It's 9 o'clock in the morning. They are not drunk like you suppose. People don't get drunk that early in the morning unless they're alcoholic or something. Amen. But he said, now they're not drunk as you suppose, since it is the third hour of the day. But notice, he goes back to the word. Verse 16, he said, but this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. Remember we did the series on Joel chapter 2, amen, around 28 and 30. He said, this is what the prophet Joel talks about. And remember, Joel talks about in that restoration and that revival, it shall come to pass in the last days, all right, latter days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall what? Dream. And on my men servant, and on my maid servants, I will pour out my spirit, amen, in those days. And they shall what? Prophesy. And they shall prophesy. You know, Peter quotes Joel. He goes back to the Old Testament, the prophecy, the promise of God. And so we have to understand that Pentecost was a fulfillment of God's prophetic promised that he's going to fill all of us. And so that all believers, all who truly believe in God, would be able to experience God in a powerful and a new way. Again, in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit operated primarily through the kings, through priests, or prophets, or those specifically chosen by God whom the Spirit came upon. But now in this new dispensation of grace, when Jesus has come and had left the earth, but he has manifested his promise through his person of the Holy Spirit, the paraclete, the helper, the go-between. I call him our life coach. He's our mentor. He's our filler. He's the indwelling presence of God, the comforter, and so many other things. The Holy Spirit is available for all. So the Holy Spirit is not just for the pastor or the deacon or the elders or the bishops or certain selected few, the choir members, the minister of music, but the Holy Spirit is available for every believer. And we have to understand God's purpose for his role in the earth. He came to dwell among all of us, not just the Pentecostals, not just the charismatic, not just the Baptist or the Methodist or the Five Baptist. No, get rid of the denominationalism and understand he operates through relationship. So he wants to fill us. Amen? Praise God. Praise God. I don't want to spend too much time there in Acts chapter 2, and I spent a good bit, but I want you to understand how the initial, arrival, for lack of a better word, the manifestation of the Holy Spirit, how he filled each of them at Pentecost, from Pentecost onward, and you'll find that it began with a smaller group from the 11 to Matthias, who was added in the place of Judas, to the women that were there. I'm sure Mary, Martha, and Jesus' mother, and other women that were there. And it grew from those numbers to 120. Amen? But now, as you read through this whole chapter, and I want to challenge you, read through this whole chapter, that you'll discover that many others were saved, and the church grew, and they experienced major transformation because of the presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen? Praise God. All right. In fact, let me just walk you through so you get more of this. Read through. Look at verse 36. Acts chapter 2, verse 36. Praise God. Verse 36, the Bible said, therefore, let all the house of Israel know surely that God has made this same Jesus whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Amen. Now, when they had heard this, now notice Peter preached the gospel, and the Holy Spirit would come when people receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Amen. And as we've talked about that regeneration and being born again, the Holy Spirit comes when we believe, confess with our mouth, believe in our heart, the Lord Jesus, that God raised him from the dead, then amen, the next phase or next step of walking in the fullness of God, fullness of Christ, is saying to the Holy Spirit, come in, I invite you, you're welcome, fill me with your presence, fill me with your power, fill me with all that God has promised through your person, through your presence, through your power, amen. And so Peter preached that Jesus is both Lord and Christ. He is the anointed one. He is the anointer. He's the one that sends the anointing. Catch that. Christ, it means Messiah, the anointed one. Amen. So he's the anointed one, but he anoints. He sends the Holy Spirit, who is the anointing, and it is the anointing of the Holy Spirit that dwells within us and fills each of us. Look at verse 37. The Bible says, now when they heard this, amen, they were what? Cut to their heart and said to Peter and to the apostles, men and brethren, well, what shall we do? And notice Peter preached to them. Peter explained to them. Then Peter said to them, you've got to repent. and let every one of you be baptized, notice, in the name of Jesus Christ for what? The remission of sin, and you shall, there it is, receive what? The gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is available. But the question is, have you repented? Have you received Christ as your Lord and Savior? Have you asked for the gift of God, the Holy Spirit? Amen. Verse 39 says clearly that the promise is not limited denominationally, but the promise is to what? You and your children and to all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call. God is calling all of us to experience the presence, the power, and the promise of the Holy Spirit. Every believer. And that's why I said so many believers, so many people have said, oh, that's just emotionalism. That's just the preacher. That's just the pastor. That's just that church or that denomination, that group. And you have missed out on what God has for you. You're missing out on the power of the Holy Spirit. Please understand, it's not just emotionalism, but I promise you, if you have the Holy Spirit, he's gonna connect with your mind, your soul, and your emotion, and he will cause you to express your emotion in a more freeing way. Amen. He may make you cry when ain't nothing wrong with it. He may push you to run. You just feel like running. You just feel like shouting. You know, we believe in the free expression of the Holy Spirit, and we know when he's operating in us as an invisible guest. Amen. Fills us with joy, fills us with peace, fills us with celebration. He fills us with worship. He fills us with praise. He fills us. He frees us. Amen. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He frees us and he fills us, and in that filling, he frees us. So we're free to express our worship. We're free to worship God freely. We're not just saying, I'm just, oh, praise the Lord. Praise. You know, listen, if that's you, that's your mode, that's your method, M-O, God bless you. But I believe in being free. Amen. I believe in free expression of praise and worship and giving God glory. And that's what was happening at Pentecost. They were praising God in their own language. Amen. They were praising God. And so Peter said, listen, the gift is for you and everybody. Praise God. And the Bible says how the church grew. Amen. Grew. Amen. Grew. Grew. They continued to grow in the Lord. And the Lord added to the church souls and signs and wonders. Amen. Look at what happened in Acts chapter 2. Amen. I want to make sure I finish this. But notice the Bible says that the church grew. And many other words he said to them. He testified, verse 40, Acts 2 and 40. He exhorted them, saying, be saved. And that's the message of the gospel today. Be saved. That's the message God is saying to every Christian, every believer, every church member. Be saved. Every sinner, be saved. Amen. Be saved and be delivered, be regenerated from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly, notice, received his word were baptized. And notice how and that day about 3,000. Wow. 3,000 souls were what? Added to them. They go from 11, they go from 12, they go from 120, and now in one day, 3,000 people were inspired, influenced, impacted, and infilled with the Holy Spirit. My God, hallelujah. Listen, there's nothing that God can't do. 3,000, can you imagine 3,000 folk coming? What went from a small prayer meeting turned into a major movement, amen? Really, 3,000 people. I'm trying to help you to understand. Listen, a stadium, it would take a stadium that can hold 3,000 people to fill 3,000 people. But the Holy Spirit started influencing, impacting, and filling people so much so that over 3,000 people were added to the church in one day. Oh, praise God. gladly received it. Amen. 3,000 souls were saved. And notice, they didn't stop. But the word of God says they what? They continued. Amen. Continue steadfastly. Notice, in the apostles' doctrine, they stayed in the word. And in what? Fellowship, koinonia, and in breaking bread, holy communion, and in prayers. Amen. They continued. And the Bible says, and fear, holy fear, came upon every soul. And many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. God was working through them because they were filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit brought about supernatural manifestation in their life because they were not just operating as human beings, but they were operating in the fullness of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, now turn with me to Ephesians chapter number 5, and let's look at verse number 18. Listen, I can talk about being filled all day. That's really an extended subject, but I wanted to just give you one point, give you some points today about being the works of the Holy Spirit, how he works in all of us. And the Holy Spirit want to fill our churches. He want to fill he want to fill the church, not just bodies, but he wants to fill us with his presence. Amen. So when we come to church, don't just sit there like you dry, dead doorknob, you know, like you casket ready. Come on now. But you ought to come with your hands up saying, Lord, I want more of you. Amen. And so Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18, here Paul writes about being filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. And he says to believers, look there. In fact, let's look there. He says in verse 15, if you will, let's look at 15. He says, see that you walk circumspectfully. Amen. In other words, walk circumspectfully. And when he talks about that, he letting us know, listen, don't live as if you are still unsaved, but live like you're saved. Act like you're saved. Amen. Praise God. Live cautiously, sensitively to the Spirit, not as fools, but as wise, which means be discerning between the natural and the supernatural and what is of flesh and what is the faith and the Spirit. So do not be unwise, but walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. He says, redeeming the time, because the days of evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Verse 18 is our focus right quick. Verse 18. He says what? And read that. And do not be what? Drunk. Don't be intoxicated with wine. But he says, in which is dissipation, but be what? Filled. There it is. Filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. When we talk about being filled with the Spirit and possessing the Spirit, it doesn't mean that you got him. Okay, I always use this illustration. Oh, I got the Holy Spirit. You see, sometimes people, they act all the theatrical and act like, oh, you know, I got the Holy Spirit. No, he may cause you to do some things like that, but you have to understand the principle of what it means to be filled with the Spirit. Filled with the Spirit doesn't mean you got him, but the Holy Spirit has you. Amen. It's really being in a posture of being totally surrendered to him, totally yielded to him, and saying, he has me. I'm a yielded vessel. I'm broken, but I'm blessed. I'm yielded. Sometimes he has to break us in order to bless us. He has to crush us in order to fill us with his presence. So that is a continuous process of saying, Lord, fill me again. Fill me. It's like a cup, like a glass. Amen. You fill that glass and you drink some out of it, or you pour some out of it, then it's going to leave some space. But ask him to fill me, which means take charge, take possession, all right? Continually filling. This is a process, continuing process. As you serve, as you pour out, as you give out, then you're emptying yourself. So we have to say, Holy Spirit, I need you to fill me again. Every day you go out, you're dealing with people you're dealing with, things you're dealing with, challenges, tests, temptation, trials, you're dealing with demons or whatever, and sometimes it'll pull on you. Amen. You feel sometimes depleted, you feel drained, you feel empty, you feel low, and we have to ask the Holy Spirit, fill me again, fill me again, fill me again. Amen. So this is a continuing filling, and how do we do that? We do it by prayer. We do the same thing that the believers did in Acts chapter 2. They continued in the apostles' doctrine. They continued in fellowship. They continued in breaking of bread, and they continued in prayer. And part of their prayer and praise, all right? Praise is a way of filling your spirit. Because sometimes the enemy will drain you, and sometimes you feel dry, you feel low, you feel depleted, you feel defeated. You just feel like, I just don't have it. I just don't. Listen, try praising God. God, I just bless you. Feel me now. Position yourself, posture yourself with your hands up. Sometimes just get on your knees and cry out to God. Holy Spirit, fill me again. Fill me. Empty me of self and fill me with your presence. Fill me with your word. Fill me with your knowledge. Fill me with your joy. Fill me with your peace. Fill me with your love. Fill me with your joy, your praise. Amen. That I may praise you. Amen. It's a continuous filling of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I always liken the filling of the Holy Spirit, and another acronym, y'all know I like acronym, is CSI. CSI. Not crime scene investigation. No, but Christ indwelling spirit. Write yourself a note. CSI, not crime scene investigation. I sometimes watch that, but I'm talking about Christ indwelling spirit. Amen. Christ indwelling spirit. Christ indwelling spirit. Amen. When you have Christ indwelling spirit, you are filled, and that filling will, it'll overflow. It'll bubble over. Amen. Praise God. You're able to stand and serve and speak and just express your praise to God freely, because you know the power of his presence. Amen. So I pray, God, fill me. Do it again. God, fill me with the Holy Spirit. Our churches, before we come back, and when we come back together, my prayer is, Holy Father, Holy Spirit, fill every pew with people, but I want you to fill each of them with your presence and your power. Amen. That's what I'm praying for. When we come back to church, when we get back in the Lord's house, I'm believing, God, that God will fill the pew, but he'll fill every person. Catch that. Not just fill the pew, but fill every person. Amen. From the back to the choir, pulpit, every person will feel the presence, amen, of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. I had wanted to get all five of these in, but I'm telling you, Holy Spirit, he shifted me today. Amen. But because he wants us to know who he is, he feels so neglected. He feels so neglected, because too many Christians don't rely on him. We don't call on him. We don't pray to him. But he wants to feel our thoughts. Ask him to feel your thoughts. Amen. Because so many times you got all these negative thoughts. That's why so many Christians are depressed. Their thoughts are filled, and mind is bombarded with all these other negative thoughts. But you have to ask the Holy Spirit, feel my thoughts with the word of God. Fill my negative thought with positive thoughts. Amen. Fill my heart, because you can be emotionally wounded and not even know it. Become broken. You can become bitter. You can really become negative and not even know it. Even as a Christian, you in church, some people are serving in ministry. Amen. Broken and bitter. Some pastors are broken and bitter. Had a friend of mine, every time he would call, he served a church, and it was a historic church. And I said, man, listen, you can't go in. You're coming from one region, from one big church, and you're going to come to another smaller church, and those people are not going to think like the people of the church you came out of. So stop beating them down. Stop bashing them. Stop being negative. Amen. Learn to love them where they are. Love them where they are. Ask the Holy Spirit to change your mind, change your mouth. See, that's a good word. Change your mind, your mouth, and change your motive, change your heart. And because if we're not spiritually, Peter Scazzaro, I believe it is, has a book entitled Spiritually, Emotionally Healthy. Amen. Spiritually, Emotionally Healthy Church. That's what it is. Spiritually, Emotionally Healthy Church. And sometimes we may not be physically healthy or may not be spiritually healthy. So we have to ask God, God, I need you to feel me. I need you to feel me, feel my thoughts, feel my heart, heal me, feel me, renew me, baptize, sanctify me, correct, whatever you need. The Holy Spirit, I need your presence. I need your power. I need your confidence. I need your indwelling control. Just feel me. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And sometimes you ought to just practice it by yourself, even if you have to go in the bathroom. Amen. Wherever you can, if you live alone and nobody's there, find you a sacred place, find you a still place, and lift your hand. Get on your knees if you have to. Get on your, and lift your hand. Say, Holy Spirit, I want more of you. I want more of you. I want more of you. Less of me, more of you. Feel me. Amen. Amen. Any toxic feelings, any toxic emotions, any toxic thoughts, any toxic words, anything that's in me that needs to be taken out, I want you to take it out, and I want you to feel me. Praise his holy name. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit, one of the major things he does is he fills us. Amen. Look like I got to finish this next time. Praise God. But I want you to get that. But that ought to be part of our prayer on a day-to-day basis. Holy Spirit, fill me. Heavenly Father, fill me. Praise God. Well, I want more than just religion. I want relationship. I want fellowship. I want more than membership. I want to be a part of the King. I want to experience the overflow of your presence and power, just like you did at Pentecost. Amen? That's my prayer. I want Pentecostal power. Praise God. People ask me, what do you believe? I said, what church you belong to? I said, I'm at a Baptist church, but we are Baptist-costal. Amen? Which means we are Baptist, but we believe in Pentecostal power, fire, Holy Spirit, including the speaking of tongue, which is a different subject. Amen? Speaking with language, speaking in heavenly language, speaking in the Holy Ghost, but being filled with the Holy Spirit. I believe in every believer being filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. With gifts and the flow of the Holy Spirit. So when we talk about being filled on a day-to-day basis, fill me, fill my mind, fill my mouth, fill my emotion, fill my spirit, fill me, dwell in me. Dwell in me, Holy Spirit. Dwell in me. And that sometimes you just have to continue that practice. Feel me, Holy Spirit. Bubble up in me. Feel me. Feel me. Feel me, Holy Spirit. Feel me, Holy Spirit. Feel me. Sometimes just saying it over and over. Feel me, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, heavenly dove. Feel me. Sanctify. Set on me. Sanctify me. Even on your job, sanctify my mind. It'll give me creative concept. I want to live the maximum life. I want everything you have for me. Holy Spirit, you ought to invite him. You're welcome. You're welcome in this place and in my heart. Holy Spirit, you're welcome. Amen. Come on, try that right now. Holy Spirit, you're welcome. Holy Spirit, you're welcome. Holy Spirit, you're welcome. Welcome. Feel me. Feel my mind. Feel my mouth. Feel my heart. Come now. Say it. Say it. Holy Spirit, you're welcome. Holy Spirit, you're welcome. Lift your hand. Holy Spirit, you're welcome. Holy Spirit, you're welcome. Holy Spirit, come, come, come. You're my comforter. You're my helper. Come, Holy Spirit. Fill us now. Fill us now. Fill me now. Fill me now. Hallelujah. God, I give you praise. I love you. I love you, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I love you. 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 Fill me now. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Listen, I'm out of time. But I am not out of word. I could talk about the Holy Spirit all day. I needed to get this word out to you today. Because we need to know that the Holy Spirit fills us. Amen? Amen. If you're in the choir, ask the Holy Spirit, fill us. Fill us. Don't just fill the choir stand, but fill us. Set on each one, each of us. Amen? If you serve on a deacon's ministry or elder ministry, amen, your associate minister, don't just wait to fill a pew, but ask Holy Spirit, fill you. Fill us. Amen? Well, amen. We ought to have Spirit-filled leaders. Amen? Amen. In every capacity of the church, if you're a greeter or you serve with hospitality, a sound or the pro team or security or whatever capacity, the nursery, ask the Lord to fill you. If you're a musician, a gifted minister of music, whatever capacity, drunk, whatever capacity, you need to ask the Holy Spirit to fill you with his presence, with his power, and operate in you with his purpose. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Listen, I'm out of time, as I said, but I'm not out of word. Just wanted to share that lesson with you today. I pray that you were blessed by the instruction of the word. It's hard to really teach about the Holy Spirit, about God, about Christ in one simple lesson. You won't get it. It takes a lifetime. And as you grow in him, you learn more and more. And so, but you need to get it as a believer, as a Christian believer, you need to ask for more. Amen. Let's pray now. I'm going to close out, but I want to thank you for being a part of this teaching learning experience. Let's pray together. Father, we love you. We bless you right now. We thank you right now for this time we've shared in your word. And Father, we lift up the believers. We lift up Christians everywhere. We pray that they will hear your word, receive your word, but above all, receive you, Holy Spirit, to fill them. Oh, Holy Spirit, continue to fill us with your presence and your power right now in Jesus' name. I pray for the body of Christ. I pray for pastors. I pray for bishops. I pray for apostles, evangelists, elders, and pray for teachers, God, everyone in the body of Christ. I pray for families. I pray for our children, our loved ones, God, our children as they're in school and as they go to school, and our parents, God. I pray for grandparents. I pray for every generation that they'll come to know you first as Lord and Savior, but then they'll be filled with your person, with your presence, and the power of the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, heavenly dove, fill us now, we pray in Jesus' name. We pray for the sick. We pray for the afflicted. We pray that signs and wonders will begin to manifest, that miracles will begin to take place, that people will be healed, delivered, and set free, that the lost will be saved in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. And praise God. Amen. Well, it's been my joy to share the word of God with you today. I pray that this word has been life-changing, that you've been inspired, you've been impacted, but above all, you've been influenced by the person of the Holy Spirit. Until next time, listen, stay tuned, stay focused, stay faithful, and watch God do the phenomenal. I love you. God bless you.